Hello and welcome to Global Healthcast, brought to you by Global Health Press. In this broadcast series, we talk every Tuesday about all kinds of globally relevant health issues. I am Joe Schmitt, and with me today is Dr. Melvin Sanicas. Good morning.
Good morning, Professor Schmitt, and good morning to our special guest, Stig, who will be introduced by Professor in a while.
Yes, and I'm very happy for Global Healthcast that we are pleased and honored to have with us today Stig Tollefsen from CEPI, and you will learn all about CEPI, and it's really important you know all about CEPI in the next couple of minutes. Good morning, Stig.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to this podcast. Very proud to be here.
Very good. So CEPI stands for Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations. Sounds complicated, but isn't. And Stig will run us through a couple of slides, and you will learn about this excellent initiative. Stig, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Professor Schmitt, and thank you, Melvin, for inviting me to this global health cast. I will present a few slides about CEPI and what we do, and with a special focus on our COVID response. So as you learned earlier on, CEPI stands for the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, and the idea is to develop new vaccines to generate a safer world. So next slide, please. So if we take a look back and then see what the COVID-19 have cost us over the last 2.5 years, we have already lost more than 6.5 million lives. These are the data from the September, and the expected cost in the global economy is $28 trillion by 2025. The main challenge here is, of course, it has destroyed the lives of people and broken up societies, and been an economic setback for families and people around the globe, this outbreak. So the question CEPI has been asking is, what can we do to prepare for a potential next pandemic? Next slide, please. So to give you some background why CEPI was started, we have to look back at the outbreak of Ebola in West Africa, 2014 to 2016. It was devastating, 11,000 or more people who died, and the gross domestic product had a serious blow in those countries affected for those years. And people already being poor became even more more poor, and a lot of the difficulties. It was evident then that the world could have done more for the people who were affected by Ebola. And Stanley Plotkin, the Wellcome Trust organization, and Jon Arne Røttingen, Tore Godal, all argued that we needed to step up and prepare the world for such epidemic and potential pandemic outbreaks, to have an organization that could work independent of other organizations and collaborate to develop vaccines to help the people affected by these kind of outbreaks. Next slide, please. So then at the World Economic Forum in 2017, CEPI was launched. They had been, the organizers had been able to get finances to establish CEPI. So then at this meeting in Davos, it was the launch the first time, and the work that CEPI have conducted since started. And there are some of the famous people and some of the initiatives behind it all seen in this picture. Next slide, please. So our vision has been all the time to be develop a world in which epidemics and pandemics are no longer a threat to humanity. And the mission is really to stimulate and accelerate the development of vaccines against emerging infectious diseases and enable access to these vaccines for people during outbreaks. And this is one of the keys of CEPI to what we talk about, the equitable access, that anyone should receive a vaccine independent of ability to pay for the vaccine. Next slide, please. And here CEPI comes as in a unique position as a private public coalition. We are in the center and in dialogue with governments, pharmaceutical industry, academia, civil and society and health organizations, philanthropies, and the regulatories, both receiving funding from governments, philanthropics, and other organizations, but also able to collaborate with the public organizations and the pharmaceutical industry. And this is really key to bring all these stakeholders together to be able to develop solutions that can help people come out of, or at least support them to have vaccines when there is an epidemic or pandemic ongoing. Next slide. If you look at the figure on the right, I think this is really telling what's been happening the last 120 years. If you look at the red dot for each of the diseases listed, you'll see that's where the time point when the pathogen was linked to the disease. And then the blue dot indicates when a vaccine for the indication was approved in the United States. And you take the example of typhoid fever, were described in the late 1880s. It took more than 100 years before you would have a vaccine that could help you protect against the typhoid fever. And in general, you'll see with time, the timelines from pathogen detection till you have a licensed vaccine has really decreased. And as we now have recently gone through the COVID-19, I think it's unique in the history that we have were able to develop vaccines within 326 days from we had the sequence of the virus until we had the first emergency use license. So we have really improved over the years, and I think much of this is because we managed to establish this global collaboration on how to develop these vaccines and do it as a joint effort to do it. But then you can always ask the question, is it possible to improve this further? And I will talk to this later in the presentation. Next slide, please. So this is just a timeline for what CEPI activities since we started in 2017. We started looking at the WHO blueprint list of viral pathogens that could have a pandemic or epidemic potential, and started to have a call for proposals to develop vaccines for those diseases. And the blueprint list is also reflecting on some of the neglected. It's not present. These diseases often affect low and middle income countries where there is no interest or no commercial value in developing vaccines. And there's where CEPI come in and have the funding to help the development of these kind of vaccines. So already in 2017, we started with developing vaccines against Lassa, Nipah, and MERS. Pay attention to that. I will come back to it. But it was an important early investment for CEPI. Then another point, which is important for CEPI, is technology platforms. And later in 2017, we had the first call for asking for technology platforms. That means that you would have a vaccine technology that could easily be modified to handle another disease, another indication, by just changing some protein structures, or you could have sequences in the mRNA, DNA platform, whatever. That's a technology platform. And then we moved on. 2019, we had a call for chikungunya and RIFT. Could you please go back? Yeah. And RIFT valley fever. And again, later 2019, we had a new call for rapid response platforms, trying to develop it even further and recruit even new technologies that are being developed. And since then, early 2020, the COVID-19 broke out, and CEPI started immediately to talk to our developers in the portfolio if they could handle the COVID outbreak and modify their vaccines. And we even had three or four open calls for proposal for other technologies that could come in and help generate vaccines against the COVID-19. At the end of 2020, we saw that there were a lot of new emerging variants of SARS-CoV-2. And early 2021, we decided to have to ask if there was possible to develop a broad protective beta coronavirus and also SARS-CoV-2 variants of concern vaccine. That's you might say it's a holy grail in a sense. We have over the years been working on a pan influenza vaccine development, and now we asked if we could develop something similar for the beta coronavirus vaccine. And the call was running till October 2021, and we have just signed the contracts now with the developers to work on this as a four-year project to develop such a broad protective beta coronavirus vaccines. And later on in 21, we open up for additional mRNA technologies. Have there been innovations in mRNA technology that we would like to support or bring forward? We have also been focusing on the immunogen design. Is it possible to use artificial intelligence to design immunogens to offer a new and protective vaccines? And by using artificial intelligence, maybe you could develop the vaccine even faster. And additional calls for how to improve thermostability of vaccines, how to ensure more robust distribution as the technologies have better thermostability, and perhaps other innovations that could help the logistics of vaccine. And later in 2022 and also in 2023, there will be a number of other calls for proposals to handle how to improve vaccine distribution and delivery, new technologies to come in, platform technologies mainly, and how to prepare for the next potential pandemic or epidemic outbreaks. Next slide, please. So this slide just shows as a mini picture how the CEPI portfolio looks like at the moment. With MERS, Lassa and Nipah, the follow-up with chikungunya, Rift Valley fever, and then came COVID-19. And then also we have the disease X, which is really talking about if any disease, any viral pathogen emerges, like we saw with the SARS-CoV-2, a spillover, a zoonotic process from the bats at the time. And would we have a technology platform that could handle such a challenge rather fast to develop a new vaccine? If we talk about the MERS, MERS is also a coronavirus, and we had four candidates working on the MERS vaccine. I remember early in January, I was in London at the time, and our CEO, Richard Hatchett, came to the office rather concerned about the situation that we had read about in the Wuhan, talking about this could be a major outbreak. We need to know what kind of virus it is. We need to know how we should handle it. And then within the following days, after a while, we were able to receive the sequence. We understood what kind of virus it was. Our leadership team started talking to our already MERS developing vaccine organizations and asked if they could modify their MERS vaccine to see if it could also handle the SARS-CoV-2 that we had now learned was the cause of the outbreak from Wuhan. And that means by focusing on the technology platforms and asking our developers in the portfolio, could they handle the challenge? We could have an early start to develop new vaccines that are against SARS-CoV-2. Next slide, please. So yeah, this is just what I talked about, the early MERS and the CSX investments. Nobody could predict that the SARS-CoV-2 would happen. It was actually a disease X that jumped over from the bats to humans and caused this first epidemic and then later a pandemic. The CEPI thinking and mindset about having technology platforms, having the ability to prepare for the unexpected event, the disease X, we could have an early start in developing new vaccines. Next slide, please. And I think that's really one of the keys then for the CEPI focus and how we work and how we think, focusing, of course, on the WHO blueprint list. But there are also a number of virus families where there are no proper vaccines, and we could perhaps do some initial work to develop vaccines that go against those diseases and be ready if there is a zoonotic spillover where things will break out and you will have an epidemic and a pandemic coming. So that's in a way the CEPI mindset about how we think about it. And zoonoses are really the question about the diseases jumping from animals to humans. You could say, or if you talk to a veterinarian, the veterinarian will always tell you that any disease really comes from the animals jumping over to humans. So isn't any disease a zoonosis? And that's been hypothesized that when humans domesticated the cattle, we then also saw the start of the mycobacterium tuberculosis in humans coming from the cattle. So next slide, please. This is just to give you an overview of the technologies and the companies involved in vaccine development against the SARS-CoV-2 and also the broad protected beta coronavirus calls. So as you can see, we have on the top line, you will see what kind of technology we are focusing on. You have viral vectors, protein-based DNA and RNA. That is, we have gone out broad to put not only all eggs into one basket, but to have different technologies to test different technologies, see which one would offer protection against the SARS-CoV-2 in the outbreak. You would not know that in advance if you all had put all the money on the MR technology and the MR technology would have failed, you would have been in trouble. So it was important to go abroad and then with the understanding that maybe not all these technologies will really offer the protection that we need against the viral disease. And then there could also be other aspects such as thermostability, how to get the vaccines logistically distributed. As we know, with some of the mRNA technologies need a cold chain distribution to be able to make it. Maybe other technologies would offer a better solution. What about the longevity? What about the broad protection? That's really the topic. So this slide is just to indicate that we have gone abroad. We have signed up a contract with a number of companies with the different technologies to work on developing vaccines against the different indications, either SARS-CoV-1 with the wave 1 portfolio. We have the SARS-CoV-2, the wave 2, where we started to look at the variants emerging and then taking the broad leap to the broad protected SARS-CoV-2 variants of concern and also the whole beta coronavirus class of viruses. So yeah, I think we can move to the next slide, yeah? So what have CEPI done in response to COVID-19? Well, we started early working on the MERS and the CSX investment we had, asking if they could take a step to look if their technology would work against the SARS-CoV-2 as it emerged in early 2020. We have then established one of the largest vaccine portfolio, different technologies. And then we have been working on harmonizing the assessment of COVID-19 vaccine data. So we established a network of centralized labs, as we call it. As you cannot only develop a vaccine and test it, you need to have some sort of a system how to test it to know if it really works and gives you protection. So this centralized lab facility we developed using the same standards, using the same tests, and then can be compared in between. All SARS-CoV-2 vaccine developers could send in their both preclinical and clinical samples to this facility and have the samples tested in a standardized way. And by that, you could really harmonize and see what kind of vaccine would offer a proper protection and would be relevant to develop further and invest more money. Then we have developed the tracking system and epidemiology team looking at the SARS-CoV-2 variants as they emerge and detect where they are. And then finally, our focus on the broad protective coronavirus vaccines, how to really take a step on the potential future outbreaks from or spillovers from the Beta coronavirus. And all of this was supported with the enabling equitable access through the COVAX system, meaning that anyone in need of a vaccine should receive a vaccine independent of ability to pay for the vaccine. That's really the key of CEPI. So next slide, please. So this is just to show you that for harmonizing the data, we developed this network of centralized lab systems around the globe where different analytical labs would do tech transfers, use the same assays, use the same developed standards, WHO standards for the disease, and you could then compare in between the labs the results from the preclinical and clinical samples. And this network, this was the initial network shown in this picture. It's actually about to be expanded further to have more labs in the South America, more labs in the whole of the African continent, and also in the Asia, where I see in this picture is a little bit scarce with labs. But during the autumn, now 2022, there will be more labs signed onto this system, and we will have a broader network. And I think this is also important for the next steps, the next vaccines that CEPI will develop, that we have a broad network of these labs, and they will also develop assays and systems to test other vaccines as they against other indications as they are being developed. And next slide, please. And here, just to show you even a broader network of other parties that we collaborate with. So we have some of the lead partners developing vaccines, the blue dots. You cannot only develop a vaccine, you need to produce it as well. So we have established a manufacturing network of manufacturers around the globe that will be able to produce the vaccine. And the aim is really to be able to produce the vaccine as close to the outbreak as possible. And the manufacturing partner network is being expanded as we speak and try to get even more labs in some of the areas you see in this map being scarce. So you will see South America again, African continent needs more labs or manufacturing sites. And also in the Asian region, we could have more manufacturing partners. And also we have clinical research lead partners around the globe where they are in charge of developing clinical studies sponsored by the CEPI team to test their vaccine in their populations through the clinical trials needed. So again, just to show you that the global coalition is to collaborate around the globe and have all parties represented from all corners of the world working together on developing vaccines. And this slide is just to show you how we have been working. So the Access to COVID Tools Act was established, and COVAX is a pillar of the ACT system. CEPI was in charge of sponsoring the development of vaccines and support all the research behind it. Then Gavi would purchase the vaccines, and WHO and UNICEF would distribute the vaccine and roll it out to the world. And by now, more than 1.7 billion doses have been shipped to more than 146 countries around the globe. Next slide, please. And then to my final slide, this is just to take a step back again and then talk to you about how is it possible to improve this. If you look at the curve here, you see that we detected or we received the genetic sequence of the virus in January 11, 2020. And then the work progressed. And by December 2nd, we received the first green light for any vaccine around the globe to be rolled out with an emergency use license. That is actually 326 days. And at that time point, already 1.6 million people had died from COVID-19. So we ask the question, is it possible to improve this, to do things in advance, to come down to 100 days? And if you imply this on this curve, that will be, we will have the vaccine available April 30th. And the total number of deaths will be only 200,000 people. So a substantial reduction in the number of lost life if we are able to to prepare better next time around and to be able to roll out the vaccine in 100 days. How would you do this, you may ask? It's, can you do a lot of things up front? Can you, as we did with the MERS, could you start developing vaccines against the prototypic vaccines, prototypic pathogens? We know the virus families. We know some are more prone to cause pandemics or epidemics than others. And maybe we could start working on some of those virus families to develop vaccines and learn more about that. And then perhaps also to generate the library where you have a lot of sequences available and can be just thawed from the freezer, and you could start developing a vaccine mRNA or a protein vaccine based on the sequence you have stored in your freezers, and then do these things in advance. We are talking in CEPI about or comparing to the Formula One. If you go back to the 1950s, the crew supporting the Formula One racing cars, they would spend 1 minute for a change of tires on the car. This has been refined over the years, and now I think it's down to just a few seconds from the car comes into the pit stop, all the wheels are tired, and the car is out on the road again. So it's possible to prepare and then specialize and do things even better. And still keep an eye on the safety, not to do any shortcuts or jeopardize on the safety here, but then follow the regulations and do as much as possible in advance of a potential outbreak. So I think the main message then will be to keep up the work on supporting development of vaccines, the research and the development, and then do as much as possible in advance for a potential new outbreak, establish a better global network of manufacturers, distribution, clinical trial sites, whatnot, to have this already in place. So strengthen the global coalition, strengthen the global collaboration before a potential next outbreak. And I think I'll stop there, or would you like to show just the last slide, which is actually just the main point here, the urgency of now. We need to think now and prepare for the future for potential new outbreaks. Thank you.
Thank you, Stig. And maybe, Melvin, if you want to start with some questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Stig. So before my first question, I just wanted to say, I think that perhaps all of us are still living in this pandemic, and we are still, some of us are still scared of COVID and stressed. But I guess what I wanted to say is that CEPI is really one of the most important organizations that have been working in the backgrounds, right? We've heard all the vaccine developers, but we have not really absorbed the value of CEPI in this past 2 years. That I think without CEPI, things would have been much worse. So I think I personally wanted to say thank you to CEPI and everyone working in CEPI and collaborating with CEPI, because we have sort of moved towards a phase of the pandemic where many people are now vaccinated. And I think that is in part due to CEPI. My first question is, you've shown a lot of projects. I think there are like 35 different vaccine candidates and different platforms that you're working on. I am pretty sure that not all of those are successful. There would be some projects that are not successful there, right? Is there a way for all of these partners that you work with to sort of collaborate or learn from each other, even though they're not working on the same thing?
Yeah, well, thank you, Melvin, for the very kind words. And I'm proud to be part of the CEPI team, absolutely. And I think if I can just spend a few seconds on it, we were a very small organization. So when the pandemic broke out in early 2020, I think we were 60 people or maybe 70 people or so. And then to handle all of this, it was a lot of work here. And then we also had to learn as we went on to develop this, the COVAX, the ACT systems, and also get all the finances to do our work. To answer your question, yes, we try to support our developers. I think what is different from CEPI compared with other funders is that we establish a CEPI expert team with the experts assigned with CEPI that will follow the developer and give advice all the way on how to take the development forward, and also to discuss if it's relevant to bring it forward or not. We have what we call stage gates, where it's discussed if the results are good enough to move the project further on. And then the aim is, of course, to also to be able to do more tech transfers or even matchmaking, if we see that as a good point, where some developers have a nice technology in, let's say, a vaccine platform, and then others have innovations in the manufacturing processes. Is it possible to bring them together to do things even better? So that's also something we are working on and trying to develop. Is that answering your question?
Yes, thank you. And on the slide where you show the map of the different laboratories you work on, so you have Bismideri, ICCDRB, and then I noticed besides ICCDRB, there's nothing in Asia. And you mentioned that there are others coming up. Can you share which ones are, which are the countries at least, not the lab itself, that are trying to join this collaboration or this network?
Yeah, we received a number of applications when the call was by the deadline in early spring this year. And since then, we've been working on selecting the best candidates and also looking at the regional distribution of these labs. So to fill in on the map here, we have received a number of applications from Latin and South America, and I think contracts will be signed there. I cannot reveal any names at the moment.
Of course.
And also seen quite a few initiatives from the African continent, and also labs there will be signed with a contract. And I think the same is true also from the Asian part. Also, you can see Australia is completely without the labs. There will be labs also in the Australian region and also some of the other Asian countries. So by this the call and with the signing of contracts, which is ongoing at the moment, I think we will see an even better map. But you can ask, is it good enough, or do we need to have even more labs coming on board? And that will be a discussion we have to do during the winter when we see the new network, if others should be taken on board. But I think it's important to be able to offer this service to the developers and to be able to have it as low cost as possible. So if you have a clinical trial, the sample doesn't have to travel around the globe to get analyzed, but rather a shorter distance would be important.
Melvin, thank you for all these great questions. I, for the sake of time, I have many, but maybe we can answer them in writing. And the one burning question from my side is, I really like the idea to have a vaccine within 100 days. This is just great. The concern that was expressed with the 326-day development was, how about safety? How can you assess safety in 100 days?
Yeah, I would say that even if you manage in 326 days, we took some risks there, but not on the safety side. That's important to underline. We didn't do any shortcuts on the safety, but we worked in parallel. So you would start preclinical development. If you saw you had some promising results, some good results in the relevant models, you could then move on to start recruiting for the clinical trials. And then when you saw you would have a good results in the clinical trials, you would then, here comes the really the important part, you would start producing the vaccine at risk, knowing that if the results from the clinical trials wouldn't match your expectancies, you would have to discard the whole production series, right? So by then we tried to do it more in parallel, so you would the preclinical part, the clinical part, and the CMC in a parallel race, and then evaluate at the end if this was good enough to be rolled out, or you would have to throw everything away. The question with the 100 days is, how much is it possible to do upfront? We know all the viral families. There's a list of prototypic pathogens that are of special concern regarding epidemics and pandemic outbreak. Could we learn more about those viruses? Could we try to using immunogen design methods, artificial intelligence, to design immunogens that could used in a vaccine could give a protection against the disease? So So the, it's all about preparing in advance, doing as much work as possible, and perhaps also working on developing a library where you have all these RNA sequences of these pathogens in a freezer. And whenever there was a would be a viral outbreak, you could pull out the right sequence. Maybe you need to do some modification to match just exactly that virus. But then you would have a you would have shaved off a lot of time already by using the library approach. And the example lies within the MERS candidate. So we had a number of developers already working on the MERS, and we could ask them, could you modify your vaccine candidate to also give an immune response against the SARS-CoV-2? And all of our developers jumped on that. And if that process even can be shortened down, it, I think it's possible actually to come down to the 100 days.
Great answer. I think for the sake of time, and we have many more questions, and maybe we have a follow-up meeting at some point, let me summarize some main messages from today, what you should remember. CEPI is largely concentrated on pandemic preparedness. We know more threats will come in the future, so we have to get ready. The second item, this is a private-public partnership investment or institution paid by governments, philanthropics, from foundations, from private subjects, I guess. So this is broadly based within our societies and within our nations. The focus of the work is neglected infectious diseases with pandemic potential, vaccine development for the next pandemics, and then technology platforms, equitable access and logistics. We have to make sure that everybody living on the globe, if it is in South America, in South Africa, or wherever in Asia, they need to get the same level of access to healthcare as we have in the Western world. Stig, great having you. Thank you very much for your time. Please write us which topics you would want to be discussed next week. You can download the PDFs of our show notes from the link below. Also, please like, share, or leave your comments below. Thanks for listening. I am Joe Schmitt.
Melvin. Sanicas.
And I'm Stig Tollefsen.
Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you for inviting me.